name of Jesus be lifted high here in this land.
Come on, sing that out.
The name of Jesus be lifted high, lifted high, lifted high. The name of Jesus
lifted high
here.
Sing it out this morning, church. The name.
The name of Jesus be lifted high, lifted high, lifted high. The name of Jesus be lifted high.
Come on, in this land.
Worship unto you and declare an open heaven in this place, God, that miracle signs and wonders can happen in this place. We ask that your rain would rain down in this place this morning, God. Let nothing hinder our worship. Let nothing hinder our worship, not who's beside us, God, not what we're thinking. We break off every chain, every hindrance this morning, God, and we lift this worship unto you and declare that your name be lifted high in this church, your name be lifted high in this city, your name be lifted high in this nation, for you're worthy of our praise, God, and you're worthy of our honor. So we lift it up to you this morning and declare that you have your way. Come on, let's magnify him. Hey, you're worthy, Jesus. Come on, sing it out. The name of Jesus, say
the name of Jesus be lifted high.
Come on, in this land,
in this.
of an army arising. I hear the sound of an army arising. I hear the sound of an army arising. Come on, if you believe it, sing it out. Back our land, declaring that our God rules over this land, bringing America back to where it was first founded. So enemy, take notice this morning that we as the children of God declare war on you and declare that we are the army that is arising. So we sing, I hear the sound of an army. Come on, sing it out. Dream dreams, and your sons and daughters, they're going to begin to prophesy. Heavenly Father, we stir up your presence in this place, God, and we prepare the atmosphere for the word to be spoken. I know some of you are like, this man has completely lost his mind. He's finally lost his mind. I'm telling you, I don't know about you, but this past couple weeks, the enemy has thrown some things at me that's really shaken my faith. But God has reminded me that he is faithful and that I have power in everything that I say. We have power. And this morning, I'm telling you, if you'll grab hold, anything the enemy tried to do, tried to take from your family, tried to take from you personally, this morning, we are declaring to the enemy, you thought you had us. But we declare victory in this place. We declare freedom in this place. And that is when this third great awakening starts. And that we will be that army that is arising from Rock Church. There will be an army, oh my goodness. So I know some of you may be uncomfortable, but I just want to really invite you this morning to press in. And we're going to sing this one more time. And I want you to declare it over yourself, declare it over your family, declare it over your children. I hear the sound of an army arising, letting the enemy know that we are rising up against them, taking back everything that belongs to the Lord. Sing it out. I hear the sound. I hear the sound of an army arising. I hear the sound
of an army arising.
I hear the sound
of an army.
Come on, in this place.
Let it rain.
Come on, let it rain, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, shatarabo sandarabo shitarabo sanda. Holy, holy are your Lord. Irapatalabo sitaladiria kitarabo shandarabo sitarabo shanda. Tarabo sanda rabo shata. Ila tiri aki tarabo sanda rabo shata. Ila didi anda rabo si shanda rabo shata. Re ba 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 si tarabo shata. Oh, holy, holy is the Lord. Itarabo shanda rabo si tarabo shanda rabo sita. Ila talabo shanda rabo si tarabo shanda rabo sita. Hallelujah. Ishandarabo si tarabashita. Hallelujah. Oh, ratarabo sandarabo si tarabo sandarabo shata. Oh, mighty is the Lord. Ishandarabo si tarabo shandarabo kitarabo sandarabo shata. Oh, holy, holy is the Lord. Lord, we worship you this morning. Ila tarabo sandarabo shi tarabo sandarabo shi tarabo sandai. Oh Lord God, we just enthrone you with our praises this morning. Oh holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Ishe talabo rea tarabo sandarabo shi tarabo sandarabo shi tarabo sandarabo shata. Itarabo sandarabo. Hallelujah.
You are holy, cry out to the Lord.
worthy of our honor, worthy of our praise. Ishatarabo, dandarabo, shandarabo, sitarabo, shandarabo, sita. Oh Lord, we linger in your presence this morning. Reba baba, sandarabo, shitarabo, sandarabo, shita. Ilatarabo, shandarabo, sata. Ilaridia kitarabo, sandarabo, shitarabo, sandarabo, shata. Oh Lord God. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we praise and exalt you this morning. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we lift up your name this morning. Lord, we lift up our hands. Lord, we lift up our voices to you today. Come on, lift up your hands. Declare the holiness of the Lord in this place today. Ishe tarabo sandarabo shitarabo sandarabo shitarabo sandarabo shita. Oh, we exalt you, O Lord. Ila tarabo sandarabo shitarabo sandarabo shatarabo sandarabo shata. Ila tarabo riandarabo sitarabo shandarabo sitarabo shata. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord God. Father God. Lord, we declare you are a great God. Lord, there is no one like you. Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Lord, you have created even us by your great power. Lord, we bow ourselves before your presence today. Lord, we thank you for the reign of your Spirit. Lord, we just thank you for your name, Jesus. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your Spirit. Lord, we just sing that name today, Jesus. Lord, we just thank you. Everything that you are is wrapped up in that name.
Jesus.
Sing it to him this morning.
Jesus.
Jesus, we just pour out our love to you today. Tell him how much you love him today. Lord, we love you today. Lord, we exalt your name in this house today. Lord, we lift up our voices to you today. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for you, who you are today. We honor and bless, we exalt, we lift up that wonderful, wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Let's put our hands together one more time. Hallelujah. 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 Father God, we just bless your name today. Lord, we lift up your name all over this sanctuary today. We magnify your name today. Hallelujah. 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 I know we just want to stand here all day. Hallelujah. But you know, you can worship in your heart while you're giving your offering and hearing the word, and especially while you're greeting somebody this morning. We're going to have a couple minutes to greet one another, love one another, just like we're loving on the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. How many of you are happy to be here today? Put your hands together. Put your hands together. Hallelujah. 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 All weekend I've been thinking about Brother Josh and We Want You and calling all the messengers. And isn't this a time and a season to come and invite everyone to hear what the Lord has done for you? So we're glad you're here with us at The Rock Church today, Virginia Beach, Virginia. And the first thing we're going to call for, how many VIPs do I have here today? People that are here for the very first time, would you raise your hand so we can acknowledge you and greet you, welcome you into the house of the Lord. God bless you. I see you. It's difficult to see. We're so happy that both you and the Lord chose for you to be with us today. Our worship is already being great. Our word is going to be great. You're going to have a great day today in the house of the Lord. Also, I want to invite you to put your hands together and let's welcome our web viewers here today into our house, the Lord's house. Well, it is a wonderful, wonderful day in the neighborhood. It's no other place I'd rather be than in the presence of the Lord and sharing it with you. And God has good things in store for us today. Before we get into our announcements and those kind of things, I think we have a greeting from our pastors. And we want to see that. If you'll put your attention to the screens, we're going to see.
Greetings. We've been to Florence,
Naples, Pastor John,
Venice, and Rome. And now we're here in Croatia. We want to bring you greetings from myself and Pastor Robin and, of course, Amelia and Baby Asia. Say hi, Baby Asia. And we're so glad that you guys are being able to host Dr. Paul Johansson and Dr. Lynn Lucas today. We wanted to send our greetings from Europe and let you know that we love you. We're praying for you. We know you're going to have a great service, and we can't wait to see you all real soon. And don't forget that Jesus said, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." That means that the gates of hell cannot prevail against you today, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. God bless you. Have an awesome service. We're praying for you. We can't wait to be reunited in a few days. Thank you for your prayers.
Praise the Lord. So let's stand together and pray for our pastors and our bishop. Isn't it wonderful? But before this time, we wouldn't even be able to get a message from our pastors. But we want to pray for them, pray for their safety, pray for their rest. I know they're not resting in their minds, because I've gotten a couple new projects, and they weren't even here. And you're going to hear about one of them today. But let's just pray for our pastors today. Father God, we thank you for our leaders today. Lord, we ask, thank you for Pastor John and Pastor Robin. Lord, we thank you for the blessing of the Lord that is upon their life. Father, we thank you for their leadership, Lord, for what they speak and vision to our household of faith. Father, we thank you that you've provided a place of rest and refreshing for them. Lord, we look forward to seeing them later on in this week. And Father, we thank you that you would just speak to their hearts. Lord, encourage them even in this time of rest. Lord, we ask your blessing upon Amelia and upon Asia. Lord, we ask your blessing upon Bishop Ann. And Father God, we just bless them. We bless them. We send a blessing. We send the blessing of the Lord that maketh rich to them. Lord, protect them. Lord, bring them safely back to us. Father, let us just continue to build a hedge of prayer round about them. We ask, Lord, for every good and perfect gift to rest upon their life during this season. Lord, the celebration of their anniversary. Lord, we just thank you. 25 years of following together the plan and purpose of God. We anticipate how their destiny has intersected with ours, and we look forward to the good days ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. I want you to keep praying this week. You can sit down. Keep praying this week for them. I want you to know the real date, so you can make your own card. I don't know. Hallmark says they have the very best. I'm not sure about that, but get a card. Celebrate the goodness of God in their lives as it even overflows and intersects with ours. The real date is the 7th of June, so we want to make sure that we acknowledge their anniversary. Also, we have another couple that will be celebrating their 48th wedding anniversary this week, John and Lorraine Bailey, and they usually sit over here. You guys, I see you. Stand up. Hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. If you have an anniversary between now and June 1st, stand up so we can just acknowledge you. Anybody else got an anniversary coming? Brother Ray and I have ours coming up. The Faircloths have theirs. Hallelujah. I don't know. Praise the Lord. The Williamsons have theirs. I'm doing good. Don't too many more people. I might not know your name. Hallelujah. Who's back there? Is that Mike and Sarah? Mike and Sarah, stand up. I have to remember theirs. I was a part of their wedding. I was crying through the whole thing. I think I made them cry too. We were all so touched by the presence of the Lord. It was a wonderful day. It was a wonderful day. And isn't it great that we have a wonderful life together, walking in the things of the Lord? So God bless everyone who has the anniversary. Brother Ray, are we 38? 37. Which one? 37. It was so good I added a year already. So
Praise the Lord. Wonderful. You know, I met that young man here in the church, and I don't know if any of you ever heard our story, but it's kind of funny. Is that Brother Ray, I worked in the Bible school. I was the registrar and Sister Betty's secretary. And Brother Ray kept coming up to my office and signing up for classes. But he never went to class. There was a little bench in front of my desk. Sister Joni, he just kept sitting there. And I'm thinking, how are you going to pass this class? You're not going to class. The only classes he went to were mine, but he didn't do the work in my class either. He just, I thought, what is up with this guy? I'm like beginning to wonder. And at that time, I used to help Sister Betty. We used to try to cater all the church weddings at a discount price, and I was a very financially challenged Bible school student, so Sam's Club hadn't come out with meatballs yet. And we would roll all those meatballs, mix it all together, and then all of a sudden, Brother Ray started showing up at Sister Betty's house at the meatball fest. And it wasn't all that unusual for, you know, Bible school students to show up at her house, but I thought, he doesn't really look like a meatball roller to me. But he would come, and he would come, and he would be helping us carry stuff to and from the weddings and setting up. And I just kept thinking, something is very fishy here. But I wasn't getting it. I wasn't looking in that direction at that time. And then all of a sudden, over a long, late meatball rolling session for somebody else's wedding, Brother Ray asked me to marry him. Yes. Do you remember that? Yeah. And it's just been going since then. Now, there's some wonderful stories in between of, like, he and another guy flipping a coin over asking me out. I was like, you know, this is a really strange church, but God has called us together, and, you know, I'm sure that if I was still rolling meatballs, he'd be helping me. He hasn't changed. We're just thankful to be here with you and celebrating all the June anniversaries with everyone else. Well, today we have a few things going on here at The Rock, and so let's look at the announcements, be reminded of what we're supposed to be at and what time and what place. Amen?
Welcome to Rock Church. We're so grateful that you came to worship with us today, and we really hope that you feel at home.
For children under the age of 6, there is a nursery. The nursery ministry needs volunteers. Ask today how you can help. For children ages 6 to 12, Kids on the Rock, Sunday, 10 a.m. And also, Kids on the Rock Discovery Night every Wednesday at 7 p.m. in the atrium. Teens ages 12 to 18, Planet Rock, Sunday night, 7 p.m. For young adults ages 18 to 35, Epic, Tuesday night at 7 p.m. in the underground. And corporate prayer here in the sanctuary at 7 p.m. every Friday. Our Spanish service is the last Sunday every month in the underground at 3 p.m. Join us for a special time in the Word and a great time of fellowship. Bring your best dish.
Ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. Prayer is the way we talk to God. Prayer is openness. Prayer is freedom. Prayer is for the brokenhearted. Prayer is for the sick. Prayer is for the hungry. Prayer is for the children. Prayer is for the old. Prayer is for the joyful. Prayer is free. Prayer is God's gift to us. Accept it, use it, and believe it. Prayer works.
Calling all the messengers, calling all the messengers, calling all the messengers.
Told you this was coming.
We've been given a call, been forgiven, risen, we living and give them our all. Rise up from your past, it's holding you down. This moment is all that matters, the future is now.
Hey, it's Brother Josh, and we want you to join us as we launch a brand new season of the God Squad Ministry. The time is now, church, to rise up and to reach out to a lost and dying world that is desperate for an encounter with God. As you can see, the God Squad teams are impacting this community with the gospel of the kingdom. For more information, contact the number on your screen or visit me in the Narthex after service.
Again, thank you for coming out. Now let's get ready for the word.
Praise the Lord. I just got a text message. Phones are wonderful, aren't they? Can just get your attention. And Brother Gerald and Sister Stella, I want to see you stand up. Stand up. 57 years, May 30th. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God bless you. Your family ratted you out. We are so glad. Isn't it wonderful just to have moments to celebrate and to have everybody celebrate with you? It's just marvelous. 57 years. Sister Stella, I got to get some pointers from you. I'm sure you got a lot of good ones. We have a few follow-up announcements that I'd like to make. One is we need to finish reading the book of Mark for this month. I'm excited that we're in the New Testament. Finally, Old Testament took a lot of time to read, so this month, the book of Mark. Also, for Fiji Missions, we have a new project for Fiji Missions, and I don't know, some of you may already know it, but I got a text the other day, or maybe it was an email, it was something. And we are planning, because of all the devastation to Fiji and the kids and this and that, is that we are planning to send on our container 1,000, not shoes, I mean, we are doing that too, but we are going to do 1,000 backpacks. And so we need your help. And I can agree with you, it's not the easiest time to find school supplies, but yesterday I found 630 packs of colored pencils. I found 1,288 glue sticks and more. But we need help with paper supplies. So if you could check out, I know Dollar Tree has notebook paper and composition books, and anything else that you would like to donate along with that. But we have a big bin out here for Fiji. It's like right about where my hand is pointing, and it would be good to get them in the next couple weeks because we don't, I don't think we have a container date. Abby, do we have a container date yet? 4th of June, it's arriving here or it's leaving here? The 4th of June, the container leaves. So we have all week. This week to collect the rest of those supplies, and I'm very excited, and you guys know that I love school supplies. I love finding them. Yesterday I was not weary and well doing. I think I was maybe irritating the person that was with me. I said, let's try one more store. Come on, let's try one more store. I want to have some things finished, and we did finish pencil top erasers, and we finished up pencil sharpeners. But we still need more things. So if you can look at the paper part, I'm going to be diligent to try to find the rest of the things. But anything you want to donate, it will go there, and we will get it in the hands of somebody at our school or the other schools. We don't have 1,000 students yet, but I'm believing for 1,000 students in our school. And until we do, we'll just keep sowing seed into all the children of Fiji, and we'll find them showing up with their families at our church. And so please be diligent this week. Go shopping, bring a bunch of stuff back Wednesday night, because I know you want to come back to church on Wednesday night, so you can bring your school supplies with you. Also, Fiji Missions has water jugs at every entrance, and we are not filling them with water, we're filling them with coins. And so if you've never saved coins before, it's real easy. When you get change, just put it, I have a flower pot in my car, and I fill up the flower pot, and then I dump that into something else, and I'm already promised my jug, which is about this big. I have my own water jug, to one of our missionaries at sowing into their ministry. But just you can just bring it handful by handful. Purpose in your heart every time you come to the house of the Lord. Even if you're coming for a deacons and elders, the altar workers ministry, bring a handful of change, and let's bless our missionaries as they make their way to Fiji. Well, we are calling all the messengers, and I think that, how many of you have heard that song in your head
beyond church. So I find myself, I'm driving to church, and I'm thinking, calling all the messengers. And I love it. I love to be reminded of what we're doing. So anyone, how many of you have been blessed by the Lord? How many of you are called and chosen of the Lord? And how many of you have a testimony? Now, if you don't have a testimony, we'll have an altar call and help you get one. But we all have a testimony, and so participate in the God Squads. Yesterday was the first informative meeting, but I'm sure that Brother Josh or others will put all the right words and tools in your hand. And we are going to start our official launch on this coming Saturday, May 28th. And what time are they meeting? 4 o'clock in the Planet Rock Narthex? Or 4 o'clock in the Planet Rock Narthex. And we're going to gather for prayer and get the God Squads launched. So you'll want to be a part of that. Now, Memorial Day is right upon us. It's next Monday. And the Sunday before the Monday, I think you saw the video clip on it. We're inviting all of our military, active and retired, to wear your uniforms. And it's just always such a special time for us here at the Rock Church to honor our military accomplishments and achievements, and for praying for God's blessing, continued blessing upon them. So you won't want to miss it. But also, the day after, the real Memorial Day, Brother Garna and I call them the Epics. It is Epic Ministry, but I call all of you who are in there Epics. All of the Epics. Are you there? Are you there? I can't. Can y'all be a little louder? I mean, you know. Yeah. Okay, so we're having a picnic, and even if you don't go on Tuesday night to our young adult ministry, ages 18 to 35, we are having a picnic Monday, May 30th, 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., and the cookout will be at Woodstock Park, Shelter 2, and Epic will be providing the meat and drinks, but we're asking each attendee to bring a side or a dessert, and our Epic leaders are going to meet you in the Narthex right after church at the Epic booth to sign up. And this is great. It says there will be plenty of games, prizes, and food. So visit the booth or contact Brother Garna here at the church. Amen? That's the conclusion of our anointed announcements. And I'm going to ask the ushers to get ready for our seed faith offering, and I'm going to ask Minister Tammy Strickland to come up because our seed faith offering is especially dedicated. Yeah, give it up for Sister Tammy. Another one of my favorite Stricklands. And she's going to give us the vision behind our seed faith offering today. How many of you like to know what you sow into? And we know that our current generation, that will also be our future generation, is a very fruitful field to sow into. So Sister Tammy's going to give you what the blessing is about and pray for our seed faith offering.
Good morning, church. Good morning. As you guys know, I have the awesome privilege of pouring into the next generation. And the scripture that we're using for this upcoming event we have today is from 1 Peter 2:9 that says, "You are a royal priesthood and a holy nation." And how many of you believe that our students, our young people, are our future? And we know that God has called them to be royal. God has called them to stand up and take their place in and throughout the earth to make a change and to impact this world for Christ. And so what we've had the honor all month is teaching them about what it means to walk as royalty, as sons and daughters of the Most High King, being pure, being righteous, standing up for integrity. In a world that tells them that God is dead, in the world that tells them that God is small, we're reminding them that no, God is big and he's ruler, he's king, and he can be king in your life, and he can teach you how to impact the world. And so tonight we have an amazing event that we're doing for our students, all for them. We are going to have them dress up. We know it's prom weekend, but the real celebration is in the house of God. And we're going to let them dress up. We are going to have a really special guest tonight. We have Bishop Rosetta Cox is going to be with us tonight, and she's going to be speaking the word. We have live music and food and all kinds of great things for our students. So your donation this morning, your offering this morning, goes to this program that we're doing for our students. All of it will go to blessing them. All of it will go to the things that we do for them, not only the activities, but the items that we try to put in their hands, the tools that we try to put in their hands to ask them to continue to deepen their relationship with God and to grow in the word of God. And if we want our young people to be the future, how many know we have to invest in them? We have to give into them. And when you do that, I want to remind you guys that you're sowing a seed, and that seed will continue to grow. And I believe that the mark that we make today, it does determine our future tomorrow. And I know that if we do it for the King, as he said that we would do, as he said to commit these things in 2 Timothy to faithful ones, that they may teach others also, we're going to have a tree planted by the rivers of living water that cannot be moved. And I believe that our students are that future and that tree that we'll see. So let's just bow our heads this morning. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have today to sow seed into good soil. Father, we ask that, Lord, we would give unto you today, and that seed, Lord, would go beyond just monetarily things, oh God, but it would go, Lord, into hearts, into lives, and that it would make a difference, oh God, for everyone giving today, Lord, no matter how small or big, oh God, Lord, bless it, Lord, because it comes from the heart. And Father, we ask that you would bless our students today, bless our future, God. We pray for every student in this house, Lord, even those that we have yet to meet, oh God, the ones that we're reaching out to, Lord, let your power of your presence reach them where they are today. God, we know how serious the time is, and we know, God, that you are still in control, that you're able to do above and beyond what we could ask or think. So, Lord, miraculously today, multiply every gift, bless the giver. In your awesome name we pray. Amen. Our children choir. Let's give it up for them, guys.
First Corinthians chapter 14 verse 10 says, "There are, it may be, so many voices in the world, and none of them is without signification."
The Lord God communicates to his children so that we know his voice. The clearest, most certain way is through his word. Jeremiah verse 29:11. Tell us, "I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans of welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope."
Let the words to this song assure you and help you hear the Lord personally tell you, "I know the plans I have for you."
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Our Children of Destiny Choir. Hallelujah. I think they know more scriptures than some adults. We got to get on the ball there. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask the ministry team to get ready for our tithes and offerings. And it's a wonderful thing to be able to give to the Lord. We know that tithing is a promise blessing from the Lord. I keep thinking of the word of the Lord that we received concerning out of Malachi. Not just that the windows of heaven are open, but God is on our side, and the 2016 is a year when God is going to rebuke the devourer for the sake of his people. As we give today, as we just honor God in our giving, whether it's an offering you have or that you're weak to tithe, isn't it just a wonderful privilege? As David said, he asked the question, who are we, O Lord, that we are able to give unto you? Because all honor, all riches, everything is in your hand. So today I want to ask you to stand and remind you that we have a few areas that we can sow into. Of course, our ministry team is here to receive the tithe, and we have the benevolent offering that goes to our pantry, helps us to buy some extra things that we need from time to time that you don't see coming into the pantry. Sometimes it's milk or formula or eggs or cheese. We always have something else to give to those who come to receive from us. Also, we have our missions globe, and if you have an offering, not just for Fiji, we also support ministries in Liberia and in India. And God has just given us just an opportunity to sow the word unto the nations. And also, if you have other pledges that might go somewhere else, or you just want to put something in this bucket, that's another area that we have for people to put for pledges that they've made in other areas. So today, I'd like you to get your victorious reading card. Read along with me. Out of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 25 through 30. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, and yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? And our response today, as I give in today's offering, I resist all thoughts and feelings of anxiety, worry, or fear. I confess that I am a child of God. God knows me and loves me. God knows my smallest needs and my largest needs. God is faithful to watch over me. He watches over the birds of the air and the lilies of the field. I joyfully give today with faith and not with fear. Amen. I'm going to ask you to come. The ushers will bring you from the back. God bless you as you give today.
Thank you.
the Lord. Stretch your hands towards the offering. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you put in our hands to give today. And Lord, we do declare, Lord, you are good all the time. Father, we set this offering apart to do your work, to do your ministry, to do every vision that you have spoken. And Lord, we thank you for people who supply, Lord, provision, Lord, at your hand. Father, bless, Lord, this household of faith. Exponentially multiply everything that is given, Father God, Lord, that we might do the work of the kingdom. And Father, bless every household, Lord, those who gave and those who desire to give. Lord, just put in our hands, Lord, and we vow to be faithful people, Lord, to sow into the kingdom of God. We bless you and we bless this offering in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. We have a special treat this morning, and I am going to ask you to remain standing just for another moment. It's your last moment to stand. You're going to be sitting. But we have a very special guest ministry this morning, a friend of the Rock Church, one of my favorite people that ministers the word, someone who has the same heart for the world, has sown into missions all his life, and he has some of the best stories I have ever heard. And we just know that he has just sown into not only his own mission fields, but into the lives and hearts of young people and middle-aged people and more than middle-aged people, tools and resources to just spread the message of the gospel. And I'd like you to put your hands together and give just a warm welcome to Dr. Paul Johansson, who's coming this morning. And also, I'd like you to greet his faithful sidekick, lovely, lovely woman of God, and also a woman of the word, married 60 years this year. Woo, 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 woo! Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated.
I couldn't miss that. I couldn't miss that. Walking these years together in many different countries. What a joy to be here. I missed it. I'm trying to redeem myself because I was supposed to come down here on a snow-driven day way back in the wintertime, and we were completely snowed out on the north side. All the churches were closed, but down here, God was moving, so we weren't able to get out, and I thank you for understanding that. It was a little difficult. I'm glad to be here, see my wonderful friends, Herman and Sandy right here, Cruz, great, brave people, more courageous than I am, to handle the challenges that they face and still have the Spirit of the Lord in them. That's the key. I had a chance this last year to travel in many countries. I started in the beginning of last year in China, and I came home. We took the book that we printed, and we have put it up to 40,000 across China. That's just a drop in the bucket for China. And then we came back, and we had taken, the Holy Spirit spoke to us about putting our book in the into Arabic. So I went out to Egypt and dedicated it. That was a big project, about $25,000 project, but we were able to dedicate 10,000 copies to spread through the Arab world of the Book of Romans and how they have true freedom. Came back from there and was down into Mexico for the opening of a new church in Mexico City. The first service was 2,000 people. It was an amazing time together of what's happening down there. And then actually to tell you this, that there was a church in Morelia, Mexico, which is about 3 hours out of Mexico City, where we have been going for years. They started down on the coast, way on the Pacific, and they came up slowly, different churches, and finally they got 3 hours away from Mexico City 30 years ago, and they got that church, and it's a great church where we've gone every year for the last 30 years, and that church came to the conclusion, we need to launch out into Mexico City, and so they themselves took it upon themselves, and over a six-month period, they raised $100,000, and with that $100,000, they launched their church into Mexico City. It wasn't a matter of American finance. It was them doing the job that God called them to do in that nation. So we're happy to be a part of that. came back from there, and then we went out to India to dedicate a brand new drug program that's there. Big buildings that are being built for drug addicts and so on there in Delhi, India, North India, and from there back over to Kenya for a big conference where we were able to work with students that were taking our courses and other courses. We were able to be a part of a service that was awarding 425 bachelor degrees to students across Kenya that came into Nairobi for that. So that was last year. I'm still trying to recover from that. But by the grace of God, I know this, that if your legs work, you can get on the airplane. Are you with me? So I'm telling you that to stay, we're just 80 this year, so we're trying to, we're believing for another 10 years of good years. Can you believe with me? That's it. I'm believing. I have taken and tried to keep a little, my wife says I got to be watching my weight all the time, and that's not a happy conversation. But we continue to believe God together as we go forward. I'm here today to tell you that there's a move of God coming to the world that we have not yet seen. I have heard that many times in the past. I have been around in Pentecost. I was born in Pentecost. I was raised under the pew of a Pentecostal church in New York City, where we had so much of other things. I heard that thing about Ray. He was a meatball roller. Well, he moved from a meatball roller to a holy roller. Now that's moving on in God. You hear that? That was a moving on thing in God. Let's take the next step from meatballs to holy roller. That's the key. We used to be called Pentecostal, and then they said, "Well, we're looking for some real something to really put you down with some names in New York, as New York would do." And so they said, "Okay, you are holy rollers." But they said, you know, the world said that says they're holy. We got to do something else. So they said, okay, we're going to call them carpet beaters. So we were called carpet beaters. That was because people fell down and they just had a great time in God. But today we are believing for great things, great things. I've watched it through the years. I watched the movement, the charismatic movement come in. I watched that. I watched it in the 60s, watched the renewal in the 70s, watched the other moves of the waves of the Spirit in the 80s, moving into the 90s. But you know, in a sense, to be honest with you, there really hasn't been in the last 15 years or so, there really hasn't been 15, 20 years, a worldwide thrust. There are people who start things, and this is it, and that's it. But when it is it, when it comes, we will be able to stand up like Peter and say, "This is that was prophesied on the day of Pentecost. This is that." What is that? That is what Joel talked about, the coming of the Holy Spirit, the release of the gifts of the Spirit, the work of the Spirit, the sons and the daughters, all of them involved in what God wants to do. And we're believing for it. I know the world is saying that the youth are sort of going down a slippery slope, and we're seeing this and we're seeing that, but I have news for you. You know, some years ago, my brother was taking a course at New York University in the city there in church growth and church history, and the professor stood up there. She was a woman that said, you know, this was back in the 70s, she stood up there and she said, you know, when I was a young person in college, in seminary, I wrote my thesis. And my thesis was on the demise of the church, that the church is going to come to an end. That was what she wrote about. But she said what I didn't know about was the Jesus movement, she said. Because the Jesus movement came in like a powerful force and electrified the church. They came in with all kinds of things. They came up dressed like you can't believe it. They came in with hair down to their ankles. They were all different, but it brought a new challenge and a new life, and that's the thing we need today. Amen? A new life, a new energy of the Holy Spirit. Not a forced, not a mechanical thing, but a new energy of the Holy Spirit. And so I want to speak about that for a few moments and to talk even to these some officers in training here of what are we getting ready for? We must be prepared. You know, when the prophet was praying, the Lord said, do something. He said, dig ditches in the sides of the hill, because when I send the rain, it will need to have a place to cavities to catch that rain. And he said, you begin getting ready for it, and when you get ready for it, I will send it. Are you there? He said to the prophet as he stood on the Mount Carmel, he said, you get the offering ready and you do exactly as I said and put the right water on it and do this and put the sacrifice in the right place. When you get it all done, I will send the fire. Oh, we can't bring the fire. He sends the fire. He sends the fire on offerings that are offered to him according to his purposes. I want to read to you a scripture that is found in Jesus talking about it in Luke 19. I have it right here. I put it out so I can see it. Luke, this one in 19, verse 44. He said, and he said in that day, prophesying about it, he said, and he shall lay thee even with the ground, talking about the judgment coming upon Israel and upon Jerusalem, and thy children with thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another. And he said the reason, because that destruction was coming, was because you have not known the day or the time of your visitation. In other words, there is a day for visitation. There are things that God does. You know, in your ordinary life, as you're going through life, God is trying in many ways to visit you in different places. Sometimes you'll be at a light and things are very slow and the light's red and nobody's moving and you're upset. Lord, you know, we got this moment. Lord, what are you saying? Instead of being upset, listening for the voice of God. This is what God wants to speak to us. And Jesus goes on in the fourth chapter of Luke, and he says this. But I tell you, right now he's in a synagogue talking to the religious people. He said, but I tell you, verse 25 to 29. Many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias. And the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months with great famine was throughout all of the land. But unto none of them was Elias sent, save to Sepphora, a city of Zion, unto a woman that was a widow. Verse 27. And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elias the prophet, and none of them were cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian. And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, they were filled with wrath and rose up and thrust him out of the city and led him into the brow of a hill whereupon the city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. Now, Christ was in a very religious place. He was in what we could even say a church, a synagogue, a religious meeting place. And he looks out to those people and he says it very clearly. He says it this way. He said, I want to tell you that visitation comes when you are able to follow through on what I have told you to do. Here it is. When I look at the visitation, that the other visitations that came, I realize that even in Acts 2:3 and verse 19, Peter is preaching, and he says this. He says, there are times of refreshing that come from the Lord. We need to be prepared for the times of refreshing. Amen? We are waiting. Well, then he says, well, how are those times come? What kind of people is it that he uses? He says there, when there are two parts to visitation. There are two parts, and I want you to speak about them for a few moments. The two parts of visitation, we see it there in Revelation. Revelation says it this way in 3 and verse 20. He said, behold, I stand at the door and. So he does his part. He's doing the knocking. And then he says, if any man will open, that's our part. If any man will open the door, then here comes his part. I will come in, and then here comes your part. You will eat with me, and I will eat with you. In other words, there is a combination of that which God brings about in bringing revival. Revival comes, as you will see in this message this morning, it comes upon desperate people. People who are desperate for God. Not as he said, there were many widows and there were many lepers in Israel, but only one was visited, one leper and one widow. Now those stories are found, as you look at it, in 1 Kings 17. I'm not going to read the whole story, but you recognize that story of the coming of the healing of and supply of the widow, and also of the healing of Naaman. This morning, I would just like to talk to you about visitation and how it comes, because I am preparing my heart for visitation. It needs more than what we got right now. Amen? If we keep doing what we're doing now, we're not going to get anywhere. We need something fresh, dynamic, explosive, crazy. That's what we need. We need something. We need something. People nowadays, they're looking at the government, looking at the politics, looking at the economy. They're looking at the wrong thing. They're looking at the wrong thing. We have this verse over here that says, if I be lifted up, I'm the one that draws all the people in. He said, if you put your eyes on me, I'll make sure things happen in your life. It's when you look at anything else. Here is sweet little Mary. Here's a sweet little Mary. She's living her life, and she knows that the Bible says that there will be a person born that will be very important, and that person will be born to a virgin. She knows that by the Old Testament, and she knows the Old Testament. And so she keeps herself in a pure state in order that she might be qualified. The Apostle Paul says in one place, he says, I keep my body under subjection. In other words, I watch what I do. I'm watching my whole, what I'm doing within this temple, the body, in order that after I have preached to other people, I will not become disqualified. In other words, the things that he tells us to do, we might say, well, I'm just going to do this and do that. But we must be careful that the things that we do continue to make us ready to receive. So Mary is there, and an angel comes to her, and the angel starts the process. And the angel says, Hail Mary, you're highly favored, God. And then he says this very clearly to her, and he asks the question. He says, you know, you're favored of God, and he tells her that there is going to be, you're going to have a child, and Mary has a, well how? So there is the God part, and there is the my part. We're working together. It's an honest question. It's not a question of unbelief. It's facing the obstacles that are there, the impossibilities, the human impossibilities. I say, how? Not with unbelief, but Lord, you're going to have to show me how. And so she says, it'll be like this. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and you will conceive and bring forth a son. Oh, now I know how. Now I know how. And now comes another response. Mary's response is, be it unto me according to thy will. I want you to see that when God begins to move, there is always an interaction with you personally. In other words, it is not that the whole thing comes down, oh God, come upon our church, and suddenly there it is. No, in fact, we read suddenly on the day of Pentecost. The day of Pentecost, it says, and as they were there in that one room, all in one unity, in one spirit, and so on, suddenly. I'm glad that suddenly is, how can it be suddenly? They were sitting there for a number of days waiting. They were anticipating. They were anxious to see, and in fact, they had heard the command that if you want to receive this gift, go together and wait. And they went. 500 people heard the command, and when the waiting came, it was 120 left. So that's about average. Nothing has really changed. God is saying to us this morning, I am doing a great thing, and I want to prepare my heart for it. And so Jesus talking, first point I want to bring to you in these two things that I see are operative in revival or visitation. Number one, I see desperation brings visitation. Desperation brings visitation. Now, these people, that are being talked about. I'm just going to refer to them. I have their whole accounts before me right here, but it's not necessary to read them, because he said that there were on that day when he was preaching in the synagogue, he told them that there were many widows in Israel, and then he said there were many lepers as well. We don't know the name of the widow, but we do know the name of the leper. I want you to see this. Here is a woman who has come to the end of herself. And in comes the prophet. And the prophet begins to talk to her. And the prophet says, you know, he says to her, you know, the key is this, that you are to make me a cake first. Now, I want you to hear the chemistry. I want you to hear the way that this thing works out. In my 62 years of ministry, here's how I see it working. Born in Pentecost. Didn't get in when I was 80. I got in when I was, before I was born, I was born in Pentecost. You know? On the fighting under the bench. Just always involved in the work of the Lord. The first thing is this. The prophet came to the woman. Where did the action begin? With the woman or with the prophet? With the prophet. God starts the action. And he puts a feeler out. Are you listening to me? He puts a feeler out to see whether or not are you interested in him doing anything. Got a feeler out. And as that feeler goes out, he says to that woman, make me a cake. And her response is a little bit of big time expression of desperation. She said, hold it. I got one little child. I have no food. I have a few drops of oil, and I have no meal. This is my last meal. This is the last meal I'm cooking. And after that, we're going to do what? We're going to die. But what I want you to see is that the visitation came to her out of her desperation. Jump ahead to Naaman. There were many lepers in Israel, and here is Jesus telling this story in a synagogue. And the first thing he says about this woman, he says that this woman was a woman. She wasn't a Jew, and he's telling the Jews in the synagogue, she wasn't one of you. And then he comes to the story of Naaman. And he says, you know, Jesus visited many people, and he went to Naaman, the leper, and he was a Syrian, wasn't a Jew. Now that's not making those people happy. Those people are getting hot under the collar. They're like, hold it. We're the people. We are the people of God. Listen, hunt, friends, that attitude gets us nowhere. It's an attitude of humility that gets us places. That you would even choose me. You would choose me. And as a result of Jesus talking in the synagogue, they rose up, grabbed a hold of him, and wanted to take him and throw him over a cliff. Why did he get angry? Before that it was, yes, good, amen, amen, amen. But he came to that, now that's all over. Because he was showing them that there's no way in which you can say, because I am a Pentecostal, because I am a charismatic, we are the people. First thing is this. Desperation brings visitation. This woman had tried everything she could, and she had come to the last bit of meal. I'm sure that Naaman, he was a general in the army. And he said, you know, I've been to every doctor, I've tried everything, and now this is it. Leprosy, when you got that, it was curtains after that. Now, I want you to see that desperation brings visitation. But once the visitation comes, right, then it is obedience that brings provision and restoration. It is not visitation that brings restoration. It is obedience to what he told you to do that brings the healing. Now the prophet came to Naaman, and he said, well, actually the prophet didn't even come. He sent a messenger. And Naaman was ticked off because the prophet sent a messenger. He said, I thought when he'd come to me, I'm a man, I got all kinds of... But God had to allow him to humble himself and say, what is he asking me to go in, dip into that muddy river, that muddy Jordan? And he wasn't going to do it until a little maid in his house. She said, you know, sir, if he would have asked you to dip do some other great thing, you would have done it. So why don't you just mind your business and do what the man told you to do? God will put out feelers like that with visitation. Because I know people who went through visitation and they didn't change. And I said to myself, as a young man growing up, they were angry before they got visitation. Now they're angry after the visitation. What happened here? What happened here? I had to come to conclusion in my mind and work this out. And that is, visitation brings the blessing. Obedience brings the healing. Oh, it's good to feel his presence when he comes, and it's wonderful. But you see, it's clear. That many times what we have to do is say, Lord, what are you asking me to do? He said, as a result, I'm desperate for God. There's no healing anywhere else. I am dying. The woman said, there's no provision. I am dying with my child. There's famine in the land. We're dying. No future whatsoever. And Naaman said, there is no healing. There's no medicine for this. There's no nothing for this. It's going to be a few years and I'm gone. Out of that desperation, God saw their heart. And in seeing it, it is desperation that brings visitation, but it is obedience that brings provision and healing. It is obedience. When Naaman obeyed, he was what? Healed. I'm sure that he went in the water three times like this. Three. And he said, nothing. Nothing. He went five times. Still nothing. Until he did what he was told to do, there was no healing. Until the woman, who had no flour basically, but a few teaspoons of flour, until she did what the prophet asked her, there was no response in order for greater provision to herself. When God begins to move on us by the Holy Spirit, when God begins to work in us to bring about his purposes, and he begins to move mountains, and we see things happening that are supernatural, we know that this whole visitation of God, it's coming. There is a move underfoot. I'm sensing it in the spirit. That it's not a man-made thing. It's not something that you can put a big name on or a big tag on. It's something that God wants to get all the glory and all the credit for. He wants his name fully on that thing. That's why did he look for someone who was a virgin, in order that his son could be born? Because he wanted no one else to claim that that was their son. And when God begins to move upon a body and begins to work on a body, he says, I want a virgin people. I want a people that are a virgin people, that when I begin to move, they can't say, well, it was brother so-and-so. It was this book that we had. It was this little song. No, God said, when I pour out my spirit, I want it to be that they see that I was the author and the finisher of that thing. It was not someone else's gimmick or someone else's idea.
Therefore, our eyes must be on him, totally on him. This morning, as we just begin to tie this together, I want to ask you, how desperate are you for revival? That's the question I felt when I was asked to come down here and speak to you. How desperate are you for revival? Remember, it is desperation that brings visitation. Oh, Lord, I need you. I need you desperately. I need you in so many ways. Jesus said, if we abide in the vine, and his words abide in us, then we can ask what we will and it shall be done. I hear many people quote the last part, but not the first part. Ask whatever you want, it'll be done. Oh, he had conditions there. He had conditions. He said, if you abide in me, that means you reside in me, you take your life from me, that means that I am your source. And then my word abides in you. Okay, now that means the word of the Lord is resident within you now. Not only is the present, but the word is there. If those two things are together, he said, ask whatever you want, I'll do it for you. Because when those things are in that order, you only ask what he wants. You are asking his request. You are praying his prayer request. You are praying what pleases his heart, not just your heart. I was with a fellow the other day who's got quite a large church in Pennsylvania, and he went to out there to the school, Hagen School, and it was a great time. Went out there to the school, but he said, you know, I am grounded in the Word of God. And he said, it is the Word of God that has held me. Some other people, he said, went and they got faith and they wanted to claim a yacht and a claim of this and a claim that. He said all kind of things, but he said, I was grounded in the Word. See, when you're grounded in the Word, that your faith has a source to draw from. Otherwise, you're having faith for things that are simply figments of the imagination, things you want. But when you abide in him and his words abide in you, you ask what you want and it shall be done. Because this is the will of the Father. Desperation brings visitation. If we feel we have it all together, we're not in the right order to receive the visitation of God. But if we can say this morning, Lord, we're desperate for you. Lord, we're desperate for you. It is not programs we need. It's not more of something, more of that. We simply need more of you. As we began our service today, the worship was so beautiful, and they talked about needing more of Jesus. Being open, give me an ear to hear, they spoke about. It's this attitude that we're believing for. And I believe that the vision of Rock Church, which I've known even from Pastor when he was here, when I spoke quite a few times over in on the other side of the street over there in that building, in various conferences, always it's been, Lord, we're here for revival. We want to be a womb for revival. That revival can be birthed here in a powerful way. Well, how does that happen? That happens because we, the people, keep ourselves only for him. We are not promiscuous in the things that we do and the places we run. We are desperate for you. And Lord, not only in our desperation, but we're saying this morning, we're saying to you that we're ready for visitation because we are ready to obey, because it's in the obedience that restoration comes. This morning we have some officers in training here and others that are there, and I just want to have us this morning as I end this service, because I'm highlighting something. Remember that visitation begins with a hunger and a desperation, but it must be followed with obedience to his commands. And so when I say I'm ready for visitation, it means I'm open to receive and I'm ready to obey. Those two things go hand in hand. Like Mary, like Naaman, like the widow woman, all of these. Can I obey what he tells me to do? He's testing us.
And I believe the Spirit of God is going out all over the world. There is powerful revival going on in Indonesia. Unbelievable things are happening in Indonesia. Prayer, 200,000 or 300,000 or 400,000 people gathering for prayer. It's an amazing revival going out there. In the nations that I've been in the last year, I see revival breaking out in many places. But here in America, we are believing God. And we can't be smug anymore. We can't sit in our church and say we got our churches and it's like this. And we can't. We are willing to do whatever necessary to see His glory. That is the key to this thing. It may not fit everybody. It may not fit into your little time frame or your little the little box you have for the Holy Spirit. But lay it all out, Lord. Any way you want, let it come. We believe God. Amen. We believe God. I'm going to ask you to do two things this morning. First, that I want us to just say, and maybe someone could just play for us. I would like to sing an old song. I mean, I know some of these new things, but there was an old one that we sang, and my father, grandfather, and I think great, who knows? I need thee, oh, I need thee. That one has been around for a few years. And if young ones don't know it, we're going to teach it to you right now. But I'll tell you, I need you. Oh, I need you. That's the cry. That's the cry of a heart that wants visitation. I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. You see, whether it be the revival of hunger and thirst, I said, if you hunger and thirst, you shall be filled. That's what he said. In other words, he's put some prerequisites to revival. I don't have 5 easy steps to revival. I just have what Jesus did. He said, if you're hungry and thirsty, if you're desperate, you're my kind of people. You're my kind of people because I want to send upon those who are desperate and those that are hungry. And so we must be careful because we have a lot of things nowadays. That TV and others, all the things around us, they're like spiritual McDonald's, otherwise known as sometimes junk food. You just get a little hype, feeling good. But where is God? Lord, where are you? If you really mean it this morning, while we sing this, would you just stand with me and say, Lord, I need you. And make that the cry of Rock Church to the Holy Spirit. We are preparing a venue for the Holy Spirit. He doesn't come to the haughty. He doesn't come to the proud. It says he comes to the meek and the lowly. Just like a stream finds a bed that's lowly, so the Lord seeks those that are broken. He wants to bless. He wants to heal brokenness. Wants to heal hurt and abuse. But all of these things are the expression of what he does when he comes. This morning the Lord's saying very clearly, I'm putting out feelers. I'm putting out feelers. Seeking where the Holy Spirit's telling me right now, there is a Noah experience going on, and the bird has been sent out. The dove has been sent out. And what's it looking for? Looking for a place to land. The dove is looking for a place to land. Oh, the raven was sent out and found no place and returned to Noah. So he sent out another. But this time, he sent a dove. And the Holy Spirit is moving in our nation. I say that to you prophetically, seeking where he can land. Where is he welcome? Would you sing with me? I need you. I need thee, oh. I need thee every hour. now, my Savior, I come to you.
I mean, really, right now, from the depths of your heart,
I feel I need thee.
Oh, Father, Holy Spirit,
be now my Savior, I come to you.
Just reach your hand up and say, Lord, let that dove land on this place right here. In fact, put your hand flat up there like that. And say, Holy Spirit, dove of God, right here, visit me, for I am ready to obey. Whatever is in my life, I cast it out in the name of the Lord. Anything that is harmful to that spirit, that would grieve that spirit, I cast it out, that we in this place might become the womb of the visitation of God. Together, sing it.
I need thee, oh, I need thee.
We added this,
oh, pass me not, oh, gentle Savior.
Oh, here, come on now, hear my humble cry, while on others you are calling,
oh, while on others thou art calling,
do not pass me by, come on, oh, do not, come on. Don't pass us by, Lord. Together.
Oh, Savior, Savior,
here. Oh, yes, Lord. Together, the people of God say, while
on others thou art calling, oh, do not pass me by.
Father, as we stand in this room right now, as the body of Christ, as one body, we would say, we offer ourselves to be the womb of a new visitation. It's in the air, and your spirit is hovering. The dove is all over the United States, all over the world, looking for the place that he can land. And we offer ourselves, this body, Rock Church, this body, we offer ourselves to be the womb of that new visitation. In the name of Jesus, I pray. In the name of Jesus. Bring whatever you want, Lord. Let your presence sweep to this place. And when it does, let us be prepared to do exactly what you tell us. Get a hold of us, Lord. We can't have business as usual. We must see a visitation of the Spirit. And now while you're standing, let me reach my hand. Why don't you others come? The officers in training, just step forward right here. I want to pray a prayer for you, you that are there. A few of you that are there. Whatever you're doing, I want to pray a prayer right now. Stretch forth your hand. These are being trained to be leaders of revival. Revival leaders right here. Lives turned over to God. Lives turned over to minister by the Spirit. Not just naturally, but supernaturally. Supernatural ministers of the Holy Spirit. I pray right now in the name of Jesus that the dove from above would land on each head in the name of Jesus. Land on each head right now. Take your residence in a new and a fresh way right in this place, Lord. Resident Holy Spirit, that there would be a place that comes, that we would walk in the presence of the King. That we would walk with a holy walk. And as we walk, there is in our hearts an obedience. For out of our desperation comes your visitation, but out of our obedience comes our healing. We receive it today, Lord. Let them go forth with power, in the name of Jesus. Move with power. Fear not, but move by the Holy Spirit. Move by the Spirit of God. Let no door stand in your way. No to every negative thought. I pray in the name of Jesus that the King will set up his throne in this life. Power and authority given to us by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Sing it with me one more time. Oh, Savior, Savior. Well, hear my humble cry, O Lord. Oh, while on others oh, do not pass us by. One more time together. Oh, yes, I say, Savior. Oh, Savior. Come on. Oh, yes, do not. I receive it. Let's just stand in his presence and worship him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Spirit of oh God, Holy Spirit, dove sent from the throne. Here we are. We're ready. For that which shall be born in you shall be conceived by the Holy Spirit. Not by the ways or the norms of man, but by the Spirit of God. For that which God would produce must have his image stamped upon it. Must have his image stamped upon it. Father, for this body and these precious people, I pray. In Jesus' name, together, we will create the place that the dove feels comfortable. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Amen. And amen.
Hallelujah. Father God, we just thank you for this word. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit would bring it to our remembrance. Father God, cause us to hunger and thirst after you. Lord, let us set our face to receive, Lord, your presence. Let us determine in our hearts, even this day, to be obedient to your command, Lord. Lord, let us be both desperate and obedient. Lord, we need you. We need you in this day and this hour. Father, I bless, Lord, this great people. Lord, I ask that you would give them traveling mercies as they go home. Lord, bring them back, Lord, with even a greater sense of need for you this evening. Father, let them, even as they would rest this afternoon, Lord, just move upon hearts, move upon lives. Father, help us to hunger and thirst. Lord, let us bring ourselves, present ourselves before you tonight. Let the blessing of the Lord that maketh rich be your people's portion today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask our ministers to come, and as is our custom, to sow some seed into good and fertile ground. Ask you to come and give a blessing to Dr. Johansson. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you this evening. Amen.